I'm just going to tell you all to start with that this is much more fun live. You get to meet everybody and you get to talk to people. And I used to be one of the people that didn't like to talk to people, but now there's folks that would say, there's folks that would say, I don't know, will you shut up? And I'm thankful to have James up here playing the drums and Cindy up here to do a song this evening. And this is what I want to remind everybody of. Y'all hang in at the end after JJ prays, because we got the kids coming up, and I think they're going to do the final song. I don't think they're going to do it. I know they're going to do it. So let me just take that. All right, let's get started. Oh, I'm just an old country cowboy.
Thawing out, got a little warmer today, made it all the way up to like 49, and it's going to be 70s next week, so we got that to look forward to. We got plenty of rain. We're just so blessed what's going on. Welcome to everybody that's here. Welcome to everybody out there. We're so excited to have all of you. Like Bobby said, it's a lot better live.
Amen.
Come on out and see us and have a good time. Don't forget, next Wednesday's pizza night. We always have a good turnout on pizza night.
Bob. Pizza, pizza.
Pizza, pizza.
Pizza, pizza. You
know, we always have a good time on pizza night. The kids have a good time. Like I said, we got a lot going on here. It's just a good time to just be a part of God's family and being able to do God's work and just having a good time enjoying doing it all. I'm glad to see y'all here being a part of it. I just want to say we have a roping coming up on the 6th. And maybe some of you guys that are out there that live local and stuff and all. On the 15th, though, we're going to have one on Sunday after church. And if you attend church, you get a food coupon. And that coupon is good to eat all Sunday afternoon. We're going to have hamburgers and hot dogs and chips and, I don't know, water. I don't know what we're going to have. Cookies and stuff. But it's all free if you attend church. You get a coupon. And you can come and stay and watch the roping. There's going to be a roping right after. And it's just kind of an appreciation thing from the arena team giving back to the church. It's all on the arena team. It's all on them. They're supplying all the stuff. And I guess Sherman will be buying all the cooking, and somebody will. y'all ain't got anything out there, but there's a lot of this finger pointing going on like this now about who's going to be doing what. But don't worry, I promise you, you won't get a raw hamburger. It will be cooked all the way. But that's one thing that you can't do out there, but you can sure come and be a part of and have a great time. And we're looking forward to that day coming. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you and we praise you. You're an awesome, mighty God. Lord, you loved us, your word tells us, before we loved you. You knew us when we were in our mom's womb. You knitted us together. You knew the hairs on our head. It describes such a personal relationship that you want to have with us. How close you want to be with us. And Father, we pray that we can work on each and every day growing closer and closer to you, that we can learn more about the attributes of you, your love, your grace, your mercy, that we can understand your judgment, that we can have what the Bible says, that fear of you, not a fear of pain, not a fear of suffering, but that fear of knowing that we've let you down, that we haven't been the best we can be. So Lord, we have gathered here tonight for you to speak to us and to talk to us, that we would grow in your word, that we would walk out of here wiser than when we came in. And Lord, let it not be something that we just hear. Father, I pray it's something that we take in that has a permanent effect on us. Your word teaches us that we're not to just be hearers of your word, but to be doers. That your Bible is a book of instruction. Things to do, things not to do. Things that are available to us, and things that we should avoid. So Father, we want to hear from you tonight in a way that will change us. Open our eyes so that we can see. Give us your eyes that we may see this world in the light in which you do. Father, give us the strength to show the love and the grace and the mercy that you have shown. Lord, I just pray that you would touch each one that can hear my voice, that they would feel you close to them right now. That, Lord, that they would open up so that you can speak to them. Father, it's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen.
Amen. Y'all, when we're talking about pizza, it makes me think to remember the food bank during this time. The food bank is such an important part of our community, and I've never experienced it, and I give all praise to God, but I know that there's people that are hungry and that are really in need. So I'm trying to remember the food bank. We got a box up here. Money works for the food bank. And just stop by there in town in Glen Rose or in Granbury. And,
they can send money to the church.
Yeah, you can send money to the church for the
just market, for the, food
market
bank.
For the food bank. And I guarantee you that's where it'll go. I'm grateful that Cindy's here, and I am going to put her on the spot because she's going to do the next song, and I'm just going to throw in a little bit.
Ready?
You were ready. Is your microphone, is your guitar on?
No.
You got to turn that switch. Flip that switch.
Yeah. Yes, I know him as my Savior for my sins. He washed away, and I never cease to praise him. For this truth, through endless days. Yes, I know.
Oh, yes, I know.
Yes, I know.
Yes, I know.
No longer evil.
No longer evil.
Will I sow?
Well, it's that time. Got another election coming. Who all's looking forward to this? Looking forward to it being over. Amen, brother. Amen. On November the 4th, that's the day after the election, right? Election's on the 3rd. November the 4th, half the people in this country are going to be really happy. The other half of this people in this country is going to be really mad. For some, the country will feel like we're going to be better off. For others, it's going to feel like it's just going to get worse and worse and worse. But as believers in Christ, it shouldn't carry that much weight with us. Now, I'm not telling you not to vote. Be here Sunday, listen on Sunday, we're going to talk about that. But I'm just saying that the outcome shouldn't carry the weight as so many people. How many of you all remember when President Trump was elected, we listened to all these people that were going to move out, going to leave his country? That colleges had to put up like cry rooms and comfort rooms for people to go to. And I don't care if it was Trump that won or anybody at all. Just that whole aspect of that should reveal to us where the world puts their hope. You know, and it's devastating to me. And we watch, and you know, these guys that go and they say this and they say that, and they're going to do this, they're going to do that. And these people are so bound up and so connected to this. I mean, there's family. I listened to a customer of mine talking about watching the debate with his mom and him and her arguing the whole time. You know, and some of the stuff he said he told his mom, I'm like, man, you can still talk. You know, because I know if I had told my mom that, all that dentistry work that she had invested in would have been lost. You know, but it just amazed me, and it's what got me thinking about this. It's got so many people with this fear. And like, it's going to be the end if this guy wins or that guy wins. And they have no hope in what's going to come on. You know, we've all used the word hope, right? We've all had that saying. We've all had hope. You know, I hope I get promoted. I hope we get the new house. I hope I pass that test. I hope I draw a good steer at the roping. Or how about this one? We've all said this, right? I hope I don't get caught. Right? But I wonder if people really know what that word means. If they've really thought about what that word means. Because there's a lot of power in that word. God puts a lot of emphasis in his word on the word. And it's amazing what Webster says. Webster says, to cherish a desire with anticipation. Think about what that says now. To cherish a desire with anticipation. To desire with expectation of obtaining. To desire with an expectation. To expect with confidence. So when we put our hope in something, we should expect for it to happen with confidence. Isn't that what it's saying? Isn't that what Webster says the definition of it is, right? That we should have anticipation, that we should desire with expectation that it's going to happen, and we should have confidence in all that. That is so amazing because that lines up so biblically. You know, Hebrews 11 says that faith is the evidence of things hoped for and proof of those things that are what's to come. So many don't have that kind of hope in the world today. And it's evident when we see how they are about this whole election. People have this kind of hope. And I sure hope maybe that'll happen. Ever heard someone say that? Man, it would be really great. You know, I'm kind of hoping that this happens. They're not sure, but they hope. They would like it to turn out that way. They want it to turn out that way. But that's not what Webster says the definition of hope is, right? That someone that has hope should have that anticipation that it's going to happen. The problem is, when we put that kind of anticipation in the world, we usually get let down, don't we? Have y'all ever been let down by someone you put your hope and trust and faith in? Absolutely. In relationships, it happens. In work, it happens. In school, it happens. In friendships, it happens. It happens to us all the time. But today I want to read to you a little story that's in the Bible. And it's a story that I come across, and I preached on this. I went back and looked, and I preached on this probably about 7 years ago. And I'm like, wow, you know what? That was like the second time I'd ever read that passage. And this is like the third time I've ever read that passage. I don't think I've read it again since I preached on it. But turn from Mark chapter 10. Mark chapter 10, verse 46. We're going to start at 46. It's a little bit above. Let's do 41. When the 10 other disciples heard what Jesus and John had asked, they were indigent. So Jesus called them together and said, "You know that the rulers of this world lord over their people, and officials flaunt their authority over those under them. But among you, it will be different." All right. Governments will flaunt, people with power will abuse their power, but among you, us Christians, it should be different. Now let's go down to 46. This is so cool. It says, "And then Jesus reached Jericho, and Jesus and his disciples left town, a large crowd following him, and a blind beggar named Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus, was sitting beside the road. When Bartimaeus heard Jesus of Nazareth was nearby, he began to shout, 'Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me.' 'Be quiet,' many of the people yelled at him. But he only shouted louder, 'Son of David, have mercy on me.' And when Jesus heard him, he stopped and said, 'Tell him to come to me.' So they called the blind man. 'Cheer up,' they said. 'Come on, he's calling you.' And Bartimaeus threw aside his coat, jumped up, and came to Jesus. 'What do you want me to do for you?' Jesus asked. 'My rabbi,' the blind man said, 'I want to see.' And Jesus said to him, 'Go, for your faith has healed you.' Instantly, the man could see, and he followed Jesus down the road." So many people in the world today need hope. It's funny, when I put this together, I talked about the hungry people. Bobby, and then you mentioned the food bank and all. I think, man, God's pretty wise how he lays things out. And I wrote this down. Texas alone, there's 11 million people who say they have no relationship with Christ, that they are without hope. There are 3.9 million people who live below the poverty line. There are 1 million in this state that literally don't know where their next meal is coming from. There's so many out there that need hope. Spiritual and physical hopelessness is running wild in our country. And just like Bartimaeus, they need and are looking for hope. Where can they find hope? So many people search for hope in the world, and there's so many Americans right now putting their hope in this election. You know that? They literally believe that the total outcome, whether their life be better or worse from that day forward, depends on the man that makes it into the White House. They will be heartbroken and shattered. Their whole world will be crushed. There's many a lady or man has put their hope and trust in a partner and have been let down. Invested their time, invested their efforts, invested their love and their emotions, and were let down. See, these people truly believe that this guy is going to make their lives better. That the other guy is the reason for all their sorrow. There's so many people that live their life in this world that it's either the Democratic Party or the Republican Party's fault why their life is so messed up. Why they don't have this or they don't have that or they can't get this or they can't get that is all based on their hope in someone else, and that guy is not in the power. Do you think this guy Bartimaeus been blind? I don't know. Ever? I don't know what does it say. How long he been blind? Do you think he would have been looking for hope in all the wrong places? Do you think that he seeked out and tried to find every place in the world, anybody that he heard about that could come in contact with? How many witch doctors did he go to? Just striving for hope. I'm going to tell you what, there's a lot of lost people that have terminal diseases that turn to Dr. Google and try to find the answer that will sustain them and give them hope, and it's false hope. It doesn't carry them. It doesn't sustain them. They put their hope in some guy, some pill, some company, some person, some president, some congressman. Somebody has got to step in and make my life better. To me, I think that's a foolish philosophy, even if you don't believe in Christ. I believe that we have to take responsibility for the situation. I believe that the condition our life in is because of the choices that we have made. People said, no, it's because of the circumstances that happened to me. Absolutely not. It's how you responded to the circumstances that's caused the problems that are there. People say, well, I was born in this situation or born in that situation. Terry and I, when we were in North Florida, there was a lady there, a single mom, had three kids, put herself through college, got her degree, became a nurse, went on to be a nurse practitioner. She did it. You know what? And she was a lady of color that they say that can't happen. But she did it. You know why? She made it because her hope and faith was in the Lord Jesus Christ, that God had a better plan for her, and it wasn't based on what somebody else did. It was based on what God wanted and what they did. And see, this guy here, he heard that Jesus of Nazareth was coming. He knew that there was hope in him, and what he decided to do is, I'm going after that. And the Bible says he cried out to God. And you know what's so cool about this passage? He cried out to Jesus. And what happened? Jesus said, dude, I ain't got time for you. You've done made your bed. You're going to have to lay in it. You know what he's saying? The world was telling him to shut up. Why would you put your faith in this guy? You've done too much. He's not going to help you. You're too far from God. You've made too many mistakes. You've been blind too long. He can't help you. Isn't that what the world wants to tell you? Isn't that what the world wants to tell us? Isn't that what the world tries to convince all these people that are out there searching for hope, that Christ is not the answer, that he is not the hope? Shh! Isn't that not what the church is being told by the world today? Shh! Stop telling people about this Jesus. Shh! Shut up, guys. They don't need to know about him. You know why they don't want them to know? Because they want to keep on being the guy. Because it's all about them. What they want, what they think, what they feel. This guy had searched and searched and searched. I can guarantee you, he had been to everybody he thought that could heal him. I imagine his parents took him when he was a child and tried to find everything. But he had heard that there was hope in no other but this man, Jesus Christ. And he heard him and he said, Jesus, son of David, hear my cry. And what did Jesus say? Who's that? Who's that? Crowd of people, everything going on. A blind man sitting over there. He didn't say, I ain't got time. He said, who's that? There's someone out there that's seeking hope. There's someone out there that's seeking healing. There's someone out there that's seeking peace. There's someone out there that has learned that the world has nothing to offer them, and he wants delivered. It's so cool. He had realized that Jesus was the way to get real, permanent, forever hope. But it's funny because they told him, shh, what's the Bible say happened? He just cried out louder. I just got this picture of this guy screaming over the crowd to Jesus. The world's trying to tell you that you're putting your hope in a false thing. They're trying to out-yell you, and you need to yell over them. Keep crying out to Jesus, because that's the only one that can heal you. It's the only one that can help you. It's the only one that can bring you true hope and peace. It only comes from God through his Son, Jesus Christ. That man just cried out, Jesus, and Jesus heard him, and he came to him, and Jesus said, what do you need from me? And he said, man, I just want to see. You know how many hopeless people in the world are blinded today to the Lord Jesus Christ because of the world? They just need their eyes open. They just want to see. And that comes from us. Because you notice the next part I'm going to talk about, you notice what he said? You notice what is so amazing? It's so amazing that hope that he had is still available today. You know something, another thing that's really amazing? That hope is available to anybody that cries out to Christ. Like I said, I haven't read this passage much. But the times I read it, this is the part that just sticks in my head. That just overwhelms me, that just amazes me. Jesus was in the crowd, right? And there was a guy over there who was crying out to him. What did Jesus say? He looked at the others and said, you bring him to me. Now, I don't know if the crowd was too thick or whatever, but Jesus could have walked over to that guy. He did not need anybody to bring that guy to him. But he said to that guy, he said, I want you to bring him to me. You know what I'm saying to you guys now? Jesus wants you to bring them to him. You understand that? That is the most powerful part of this passage. He says, bring him to me, to those there. He could have went and done it on his own. But he says, I want you to bring him to me. Jesus cries out to us all the time, tell this one about me. Tell that one about me. Share me with this one. Bring them to me. Speak to them about me. Tell them about me. See, people get all caught up in the healing and the great thing, but he cried out to his people, his disciples. He said, his believers, I need you to bring him to me. That's the job of the church. To spread the gospel. We get to see it in such a short little clip about this guy that hardly nobody ever knew. This guy found Jesus in the middle of this crowd. I wonder how those people... Do you see what they said? You see how they brought him to Jesus? Do you read what they said? Let's go back and read it again. This is some good stuff, guys. If you don't mind underlining in your Bible, you need to underline this up. He said, so they called the blind man. And know what they said? What they said? Hey, you dumb, dirty, blind guy, come here. The boss wants to talk to you. That's not what he said. He said, cheer up. Come on. Folks, these are some great words. He's calling you. There's people out there right now that God is calling to, and he wants to use you to bring them to him. Cheer up, he said. He's calling. You want to give somebody hope that has no hope? Use those words. Cheer up. Cheer up. It don't matter who's in the White House. Cheer up. He's calling. He's in control. one that rules the nations. His will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Cheer up. There's a God in heaven. Cheer up. There's a God that loves you so much that he was willing to send his son to die for you so that you would have hope in the midst of all hopelessness. Cheer up. He's calling you. Matter of fact, he sent me to tell you about him. Cheer up. Don't let this election get you down. Don't let this election beat you up. Don't let this election tear on you and work on you and work you over. I wonder what would have happened if they would have said, ain't got time, Jesus. You know, I got work. Kind of busy. I got to get home. The voice is on. I'm saying that to pick on my wife. That's her favorite. Ain't got time, Jesus. I'm busy. I got to go. There's a roping coming up. Or there's a golf tournament. Or there's a good football game on. Jesus, I'm sorry. I ain't got time. I got to go to the hunting lease this weekend. Maybe I can catch up with him some other time. What would have happened to old Bartimaeus? What would have happened to him? If they had said, I don't know what to say to him. I don't know the Bible good enough. You notice they didn't quote him scripture? All they said was, cheer up. He's calling you. There's someone out there today that's hearing my voice that Jesus is calling. He's been calling you for a while. I'm going to tell you, cheer up. Maybe tonight, today, maybe I'm the guy or someone in here or through Bobby's song or through, Cindy's song. She's going to hit me after this is all over. She can't do it because it's on TV now. God's calling each and every one of us. Jesus said, no one comes unto me unless the Father calls them. If he's calling you, answer. Because in the answering of that call, the blindness will fall away. You will cheer up because in that you will be given a hope that does not rely on this world in any way, shape, or fashion. What would ever happen to that guy? Would he have been lost forever? I don't know. Something to think about, though, isn't it? The next time God lays the urge on you to bring them to me. Today you can have eternal hope. So I want to say this, there's going to be an election. I'm not saying that I don't want my guy to win. Because I do. But I don't hope he wins. I don't put my hope in him winning. I don't put my hope in no political president. I don't put it in no political party. And I don't put it in no man. My hope is in Jesus Christ and Christ alone. For in him I have eternal hope that endures through all. Father, we love you, we thank you, and we praise you. I don't know who is out there that you've been calling, but I know there's some. Lord, there might be some sitting in this room. I hope that they have seen through your word that they have been touched and called and that they realize that there's hope in no other. For this blind man has put in hope and tried and yet he was still blind. Father, I put my hope and trust in the world and others and stayed blind until I put my hope and trust in you. And now I have no hope in this world. For this world is not my home. For I am a foreigner here and I live here to do your bidding. Father, I am here to tell them to cheer up that you are calling them. So Lord, if you've been calling one and they've heard tonight, today, I pray tonight is the time that they answer the call. Jesus said in Revelation, behold, I stand at the door and knock. You've been calling and knocking. It would be my prayer tonight that they would open the door. And Lord, I pray for all those that hear my voice that are brothers and sisters, that maybe have got caught up in this hopeless thing of this election. And they've started to fall into that trap where their hope is in the world and in people and in a president or a political party, that they've realized and they come back and they've hit their knees and say, Lord, forgive me, for my hope is in no other but you. Father, what peace comes with that? Peace that surpasses all understanding. Lord, if there's one out there that's going to answer that call, it is as simple as your word says. If they truly believe that Jesus is who he says he was, all they have to do is profess who he was and their need and ask. The Bible says, whoever calls on the name of the Lord, whosoever, sick, blind, mean, ornery, nasty, broken, abandoned, alone. All they have to do is call. Say a simple prayer that says, dear Lord, I realize now how much I need a Savior. I've heard your call, and tonight I want to answer that. I believe in my heart that Jesus Christ was your Son, God. That he was you in the flesh and he walked this earth to be my guide, to show me exactly what it looks like when it's right. That he went to a cross and paid a debt for my sin, a debt that I could not pay, a debt he did not owe. Father, for he died there and he was placed in a borrowed tomb, and on the third day he defeated death. He rose from the dead, Father, not for himself but for me, that I too may have everlasting life joined together with you. So I call upon you now to be the Lord and Master of my life. I surrender the reins of my life over to you. I ask you to come in and live in me and through me. And I ask it in the name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen.
Amen.
If you said that prayer and you're here, fill out a green sheet. If you said that prayer and you're out there, my phone number is on our website. My email is on our website. Contact me and let me know. I hope you all have a great, great Wednesday evening. We're so excited about everything that's going on here. Hope you'll come and be a part of it on the 15th. God bless you all.
And I'm going to tell you, if you don't mind, JJ, if you'll go knock on that door over there. I think they got the guys. You walk all the way across. I want to tell y'all, though, that's really something that has come to me when JJ was talking. As being someone who is totally blind, I want to encourage y'all to sit in a crowd sometime when you're at a football game or when you're in a crowded store, when you're in a mall, whenever you are, just close your eyes and imagine what it was like for that guy to even know Jesus was coming. How would he know? What signs? And then when he said, tell him, you know, to come to me, how did he get there? Did they pick him up and carry him? I believe the guy had faith and that God led, that Jesus led him to him. So just kind of experiment. We got our guys coming out, and they're going to sing. Cindy's going to sing with them, and Kathy. And we don't know first. First, we're doing the gospel, the pumpkin gospel. Do I have that right? And then we're going to sing us out. Tell y'all, this is a special reason these kids are reaching out to people just at school and everywhere they go. I probably would. You know what? When you can joyfully go out in your pajamas, then you're really not worried about what the world's thinking about you.
I want to go to the
want to tell y'all what, thank y'all for doing that, and if your kids want to be a part of that, if y'all are out there watching live, bring them in. The children are just the cat's meow. They're God's people. Hope to see y'all next week, and y'all come see us Sunday if you happen to be around, and come see us live. Have a good night.